This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. I am so grateful for the privilege that I have been granted to stand before you and share the Word of God. It is my privilege, and I pray that God would bless you as you hear the Word of God. May it be applicable to your situation in your life, and may it bring you discipline as well as fruitfulness in representing the body of Christ. Let us pray. Eternal God, our Father, we are so grateful for the opportunity that you've given us to share the Word of God. We pray that you'd give us clarity of thought and clarity of speech. And Father, we just ask for your anointing on our words. May the words and the meditation of our heart be acceptable in your sight. And Father, we ask your blessings on our dear sister, Jeanette Campa. We pray that you would touch her in her body. Lord, she looks to you for her healing. And Lord, we pray that it will be so according to your will. And as you have taught us to pray, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Once again, we get back to our series in regards to His great and precious promises. Last week, we shared with you from 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 1 through 4, where the Apostle Peter is writing a letter to the dispersed Christians in that time frame who are under persecution. And he was saying that he is praying that God would grant us his precious and very great promises, that through them we might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption in this present world of darkness because of sinful desire. Now that we have known that God has a plan for our lives, it is far time that we pursue his calling to obtain a fruitful life. Peter reminds us, since we receive the knowledge of God and our Savior Jesus Christ, that we add to those great and precious promises in representing the body of Christ. And I'm speaking to you from the same Second Peter chapter 1, verses 5 through 11. Second Peter chapter 1, verses 5 through 11. By also for this very reason, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, to virtue knowledge, to knowledge self-control, to self-control perseverance, to perseverance godliness, to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness love. For if these things are yours and abound, you will be neither barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. For he who lacks these things is short-sighted, even to blindness, and has forgotten that he was cleansed from his old sins. Therefore, brethren, be even more diligent to make your call and election sure. For if you do these things, you will never stumble. For so an entrance will be supplied to you abundantly in the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. This is his words to us, that we need to develop these characteristics so that we can represent Jesus Christ, our personal Savior. Verse 5, but also for this very reason, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, and to virtue knowledge. We are to make good use of our time in this world by establishing it as a priority on the tenets of our faith in Jesus Christ. We need to develop these characteristics in our lifestyle so that we can represent Jesus Christ on the belief that God sent Jesus Christ into the world to die, to be buried, and to rise from the grave 3 days. And in that we would believe in him, that we would receive him as our personal Savior. It is a privilege to be a member of the body of Christ. It's a privilege to be a child of God. We've done nothing to earn that relationship. It is only because of Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection that we are privileged to be children of God. Romans 10:9 and 10, it says that if you confess with your mouth and believe in your, if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus Christ and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Bottom line, you will be saved by believing that. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made known unto salvation. We confess with our mouth the things that we believe. And we have no problem confessing with our mouth the things that we believe. We believe that the Bucks were going to win. We confessed. We believe that the Suns were going to win the championship. And we confess, but we know that the Bucks won. Anyway, if you're a basketball fan, we are to add to that faith virtue. Virtue. Our character must conform to moral excellence. That's being virtuous. That our character conform to moral excellence and the knowledge of ethical principles based upon the Word of God and not vain philosophy as what we think or what someone else's thoughts are. We are to conform to the Word and will of God. It is in virtue of our character that God is being revealed to others by the way we represent Jesus Christ, as well as being glorified in our lives. As we represent God and Jesus Christ by living a life that is pleasing to him, by adding to our faith virtue. Matthew 5:16 says, let your light so shine before men that they see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. People are going to see your works, whether they're good or bad, and they're going to have a discussion about what they perceive of your character and your works. Verse 6, to knowledge, self-control, to self-control, perseverance, to perseverance, godliness. As we continue to grow in the knowledge of our God and his word, let us exercise self-control by not running ahead of God as if we know exactly how God will respond. Some people have a knowledge. They get a little knowledge of God And then they think that God is going to do this or he's going to react this way, and they run ahead of God in their pronouncing what God is going to do or what God will do. There will be times that we will have to endure hardships, persevering. There are times that we're going to have to endure hardships because the Bible says that in the world we're going to have tribulations. We're going to have trials. So we have to be of good cheer. Our disposition should be cheerful because we know who God is and he is indwelling us by the Holy Spirit. Even if we have the knowledge of how God has responded in the past, we cannot assume that he's going to do the same thing. Isaiah 55, verse 8 and 9 says, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts." We cannot predict or pronounce how God is going to do a thing. Even though he may have done something in the past, we cannot say that he's going to do the same thing exactly like he did in the past. We may have knowledge of God, of how God worked in the past, but we may not know everything about how he is going to answer in the future. We are to stay in alignment in our character with the will and holiness of God. We have to be in alignment with the will of God. We have to continue to walk in the Spirit of God. If we desire the attributes of Jesus Christ, we will seek to conform to the will and moral uprightness of God in our character and his word abiding within us. "Thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against you," says the word of God. 1 Peter 1, 15 and 16 says, But as he who called you is holy, you also be holy in your conduct. And because it is written, "Be holy, for I am holy." So we are to be holy before God and holy before one another. That is supposed to represent our character. We are called to holiness by God. The only way that we're going to see God is that we're holy. Verse 7. "To godliness, brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness, love. It is the spirit of godliness that we treat one another as brother and sister in the faith and not in the spirit of Cain. Cain killed his brother Abel because of his own moral failure. We don't know what his relationship was with God, but we know that it was because of his own moral failure that he slew his brother. We possess a different spirit. Amen. As a child of God, we possess a different spirit. It is Holy Spirit that resides within us. The different spirit, and it is a spirit of, not a spirit of resentment and rebellion that prevails in the world. We are possessed by the Spirit of God, exemplifying the fruit of the Spirit. And you know what the fruit of the Spirit is in Galatians. Micah verse 6 and 8, "He has told you, O man, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you, but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly before your God." That is the call upon every Christian, is that we must be people of justice. We must walk humbly before this wicked world, before our God. Verse 8, "If these things are yours and abound, you will neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ." When these traits are evident in your life, no matter your station in life, you will be making a difference. God wants you to make a difference in this world. That's why he called you out of darkness and has given you the privilege of being called a child of God. He has called you in order that you may represent who he is in this world by your character, by the way you conduct yourself, by the way that you live among people in your neighborhood, in your own community, outside of your community. It is by the way that you live and represent him. How are you representing him? Is he pleased with your representation? John chapter 13, verses 34, 35, a new commandment I give you, that you love one another just as I have loved you, you also are to love one another. Hello. You're to love one another as God through Christ has loved you. You're to love one another and not be envious or jealous or resentful or intolerant. You are to love one another because we know that love overcomes evil. Love covers us. Love covers all manner of sins. By this all people will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. It is revolutionary in this world of woe when people love each other. And this love is manifested as we deal with each other in our differences. The world will know that a different spirit possesses your life because Holy Spirit, our Comforter, abides within us, who is leading us and guiding us into all truth. Praise the Lord, somebody. Verse 9, for he who lacks these things is short-sighted, even to blindness, and has forgotten that he was cleansed by his old sins. God called you out of a sinful life. God called you out of following your own thoughts and your own desires and the will of man, and called you into relationship through the Son of God to know what his will is for your life. God wants to use your life and bring glory to himself. Who are you representing? If we have allowed the world to shape and define our character rather than the Word of God, then our lives will not be fruitful. If we are allowing the world to mold and shape us, God has a difficult time taking your life and saying, this person is representing me. Looking to the world to make an eternal difference in humanity will never be successful as long as we refuse to seek God's wisdom. And we see this in the world. People are not seeking the wisdom of God. They're not asking God to lead them and to guide them. And we're seeing that many of our leaders are making decisions off the cuff and having a knee-jerk reactions to what's going on rather than seeking the will of God. First Corinthians chapter 6, verse 20, for you were bought at a price, therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. We are God's property, and we must yield to the will of God. Verse 10, therefore, brethren, be even more diligent to make your call and election sure, for if you do these things, you will never stumble. If these characteristics in your life are at work, there is no reason for you to be led astray or misdirected. If these are evident in your life, God will continue to lead you. If you neglect these things, you will resort to your old sinful habits, as well as you are well aware of what those are, your personal battles and sins. Even though we may stumble and some even fall, God is aware of our faults, and He still loves us and wants the best for us. He always desires the best for us. To achieve a holy life, it takes a daily intentional pursuit of yielding to Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit's job or office is to lead us and guide us into all truth. And it takes a daily grind to allow the Holy Spirit to do that. He is committed to lead us and guide us. And only if we're willing to follow will we produce the results that are desired by God in our lives. We can make a daily deposit into the everlasting kingdom. Verse 11 says, For so an entrance will be supplied to you abundantly in the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We must allow the Holy Spirit to guide us. And when He prompts us to do something, we don't make excuses. Well, I'll do it later. See, because it's imminent that you respond when the Holy Spirit places a person or an idea or something on your heart to do. It is imperative that you do it to gain the results that God desires from your active response to His Word. When we do this, there's an entrance in the kingdom of God that as we are allowing the Holy Spirit to refine us by the Word and Spirit of God. Let us give due diligence today to the Word of God and keep making a difference in our world, in our community. Keep listening to the Holy Spirit and share your faith to the people that God brings into your sphere of influence. Listen to the Holy Spirit. Speak when He prompts you to speak. He'll give you what to say. He'll give you the knowledge in order to share that knowledge with someone that will come eventually into relationship with Jesus Christ. Your application? By the knowledge of God and Jesus our Lord, we have the keys to a fruitful and powerful life. Greater is He that is in you, my beloved, than he that's in the world. You have the influencer in your life, the person of Holy Spirit, to guide you and to give you things that God wants to reveal to others. He will give you revelation knowledge. He will give you a word of revelation to share with someone. By your love for others, application number two, it is undeniable to the world that God is with us. You see, because what the world needs are people who love one another. What the world needs is people to demonstrate the love of God. What the world needs is people who will justly do the right thing. Can God count upon you to be that person in the world today, to have that character stamped in their lives that this individual, you, represent His kingdom? You are a kingdom child. You are a person of integrity. You are a person who has demonstrated God's love for humanity. May the blessing of the Lord be upon you, and may God use your life for the furtherance of His kingdom. And I pray that God will keep you in the center of His will until we meet again. May Christ rule, reign, and abide in your life. Thank you.
Standing on the promises of Christ my King. Through eternal ages let his praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God my Savior. Standing, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God.
Standing on the promises that cannot fail. When the howling storms of God.